So you don't think lightning can strike again?
Huh?
You don't think lightning can strike what again?
Muhammad Ali lightning? Muhammad Ali? Oh, no, 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 no. Not in my, listen, you won't see it in your lifetime. I won't see it in my.
Right. Right. Wow. That's amazing. What class? Huh?
Excuse me? Say it again.
I said, what drove you to master your craft?
Insecurity.
What kept your eye on it?
Insecurity, poverty. I don't want to be in. I want my family to be proud of me. When I was fighting, I started. My mother was alive, but when my mother died, right, I used to make cuffs. She's been to court back and forth all my life. I've been locked up. I've been like, she's been dealing with that. She never saw anything good with me. All her friends said, I'm gonna die. Your son is no good. He's this and that. I robbed her friends. You know, I'm the nigga that, with my friend, my mother and her friend downstairs drinking, in my back of my room, I go to escalate, the fire, I go up into their house, rob that, wipe them out, everything. They go upstairs after drinking, come down, Lord, and they took it all. Lord, and they took the food. I was that way. I wanted to be down with the street hoodlum. And I was a criminal. I would have boyfriends come in, she have a date come in, and after they finish doing whatever they do, he'd be wiped out sleeping. I'd go in his, cut his pocket, wipe him off, take his watch, his jewelry. He'd get up, probably beat my mother's ass, but I got the money. That was my whole life was about hustling, getting money, robbing houses, snatching chains, snatching people's pockets out. That was my. Before I got involved with fighting, I was just a criminal. My whole life was going to be a criminal. And I was going to rob people. I was going to set people up. Maybe kill them.
Well, okay. So now, I don't think money suppresses that. It's a mentality. How did you suppress it?
I guess at one time, stealing was my life. Robbing and stealing was my life. And now I have tried to do that.
Now that's what?
Shameful to me now. I have too much pride to steal now.
Got it. They say experience is the best teacher. What have you learned today that you wish you knew when you was 19 or 21?
Excuse me?
I said they say experience is the best teacher. What have you obtained today in your life that you wish you would have told your 19, 21-year-old self?
Well, what I was told my 20-year-old, that what you're experiencing now is just a moment in time. It's going to be better.
It's going to be so much better. Would you have told you relax? Take it in? Would you have told yourself relax, take it in? It's going to be fine?
No, I would tell myself this. You know, from a guy like me, I read a lot because I have interest. I never go to school, so I read a lot. And I became kind of worldly. And I know and somewhere in Tibet, right, there's a whole bunch of monks that live there. A bunch of them, right? Probably 100. But all of them having this in their hut. They have a skeleton head. They keep them conscious that, and you know when you see a skeleton head has always got the big smile, right? Are you familiar with that?
Yes, sir.
But all of them have a skeleton head in their tut to let them know life is a joke.
Mm.
It's all over, we're going to be a skeleton head, then we're going to have a big smile on our face. I don't expect anything. I wanted to tell you, that's why I don't get disappointed anymore. Because I don't expect anything.
You said anymore?
Yeah. Because I saw the poorest people in the world, but they were so happy. They couldn't, they're so poor they can't, they have no liquid in their body to cry. They cry as Christians, right? But why they're happy? They don't expect shit. A guy like me expects everything. Just in case I do something, I expect $1 million to do this. And there's nothing here to do this. I want $1 million. What a prick I am. So you know what I mean? So I just look at stuff. I don't expect anything. It's on, I don't manage me, but I don't expect shit.
Wow.
I got a better relationship with my wife. Listen, I see my wife talking to a guy that I don't know that well, and they talk like they had a relationship. Only one's going to be upset is me. I don't care. My whole job is to keep my side of the street. I love my wife to death, die for it, all that bullshit fight, but, you know, I ain't going to get into a business no more. I ain't going to do that no more.
You said no more.
Yeah. I used to be fucking husbands and shit. Not no more. Fuck that shit, nigga. Only one go. Me.
Wow.
He's fucked. They're laughing at me, but she, you know, I'm going nuts. I don't get nobody's business anymore. Right?
But you said nobody's business. Y'all are one. You said nobody's business.
We are one. See, Charlie. Her being my wife and me being her husband, that's our identification. That's our identification to the world, who we are. Mm-hmm. Now that we have that settled that to the world that this is we're wife and husband, now we have our life to settle and get to become appropriate. And that's a lot of work. And so from now to 11 years, I don't think this will last the first year. So we made so much progress within that 1 year.
What were the tools that you used to get there? How'd you get there?
With a bad memory.
You said bad memory. Elaborate.
I don't sweat the small things.
Got it.
I don't sweat nothing. I don't sweat a path. I don't sweat nothing.
Got it.
Well, it is me, because I'm talking to him there. When you get an interview with somebody, you tell them that, you know. See, they're always telling me, they listen to me when I'm
talking. How did fatherhood impact your life, not having your father around you?
I don't know. I don't know nothing about fatherhood. I just do it. You know what I mean?
Do it?
There's no particular way I have to father. If my kids are out of line, I tell them they're out of line. Mm-hmm. And when I'm out of line, they tell me I'm out of line. We got a good relationship. There's no beating. Don't beat him like me. Like I got so many beats. I got beaten almost every day.
Mm.
They don't know. And if my kids never complain about me, I thought they had my father for a while. You have something to complain about.
Right.
I'm with them every day. My father wasn't here. My father wasn't here.
Wow.
From my mother. That was so I became like my father. Until I grew up. My father never grew up. Different thing that I grew up.
You think that it was because of your exposure, the fact that you were able to see something outside of the, you know, the four corners of your block?
Yeah, right. My father and my mother were fly when they, you know, they hung out with Malcolm, Miles Davis, all those fly guys from the swing era, 40s and 50s and 60s and 70s, and then she died in 82. They were ballers. They were playing. My grandfather had money in the States and stuff. They were having a really good time. If I send you a picture of my mother, you know she had money in her era.
Wow. What was your relationship with your mom?
Not good.
Why wasn't it?
My mother was like a borderline prostitute, and that didn't live well on me because she would do it in front of us. It was just that world, you know, and that's the world I come in with. So that's probably where I had my experience with women. That's why my experience with women was always bumped.
Right. Yeah, I have a saying that your mother's the first woman you fall in love with or out of love with, as well as your father.
No, nigga. I married my wife because she got characteristics of my mother. That's what all men marry their mother.
Mm.
Even if they're not conscious of it. Even when they hate their mother, they marry their mother. That's the only woman they know about love from. So that's the only way they can perceive of love. It's from even that cranky-ass woman who they're married. But if they keep each other, that.
Wow.
That's just really black, hate love, gutter love. That they fight all day, but they kill somebody else that'll fight against them. It's just really gutter love. Gutter shit.
So, speaking of love, do you love Mike Tyson? You back?
You go.
I said, speaking of love, do you love Mike Tyson?
Hey, listen, right? Sometimes I have to break up with him. Because when I fall in love with him, I have no fucking competition.
That Wi-Fi is crazy, Mike. That Wi-Fi is crazy.
My love again?
I said, yeah, yes. Yeah, I'm still on that. I'm saying that. Still talking about
so you what, tell loving me about, Mike Tyson. Tell me about me loving myself. What should I do? What characteristics show self-love?
You find out where your flaws are at, right? So you want to strengthen those, right? And the areas that you're loving of people, you find out things that make you feel good, and you strengthen those as well. So you suppress the things that you know that you make you what you call an asshole, I guess. You know what I mean? Try to get, because I do what you call an evaluation on myself. I do an audit on myself every year around my birthday.
What do you call that, baby? Observation.
Well, I call it audit, right? So I do an audit. So what I look at, I evaluate. My birthday comes December 20th of each year. So around December 18th, I start evaluating my life. Who didn't matter to me? Who didn't I give my all to? If I gave one, like say I gave you 20%, I gave Will 80. I'm going to take the 20 from you and give Will that 20, give him 100. Because I'm wasting my time and your time. We're not able to benefit. People come into your life for two reasons. They come into a pact in a positive way or a negative way. There's only two things going to happen.
No, life, people come in your life because you want them in your life. You gave them messages to come in your life.
Mm-hmm. To impact it in two ways.
No, no, no. This is bigger than impact. You know, guys, when you see people.
That Wi-Fi, Mike.
Hey, listen, right?
Mm-hmm.
You know, when people come in your life, they come in your life sometimes because you're both looking for the same thing.
Mm-hmm.
Sex addicts or drug addicts or whatever. When they come in the room, they know who's who, but they're looking for the same thing. They look out each other. They call each other from far distance. It's like telepathy. They call each other and eventually they meet each other. That's how the world works. It doesn't work. They come in your life to hurt you. They come in your life and then you make what happens out of it. Say they do something like steal money. It's up to you to say, I'm finished with that guy. I say, hey, you're bigger than the money. Maybe we can understand and show some compassion. I was made by beat the fuck out of me, kill him. For what? Fuck. I saw some people kill people for less, but just say $1,000 like you affected me, violated me. He has to die. Because if he violates me, everybody's gonna violate me. That's why he died. That's why most people die, because you can't let nobody know that this guy violated me. After the kill, if he violated me, you see what happens.
Hmm. Wow.
You from Philadelphia, buddy. I know they do the same thing down there.
Absolutely.
Absolutely.
Absolutely. Absolutely. But I would say to you, people are intrigued by what's going on, what makes Mike tick. What makes him happy and what ticks him off. They want to know that. Because again, they're looking at it, you know, I mean, from a distance. They don't know. They want to know. What makes him have that time bomb, if you will? And how does he suppress that time bomb?
Big, right? My time bond comes from my trauma. Things I've dealt with, what, sexual abuse, or just being beat up all the time. Or just watching your mother being beat up, or watching your mother fuck all the time. So you get that trauma. So I look at life, my life is different. I look at life from a different eyes than probably you or other people.
Well, we've been talking, man, you've been talking, and you've been giving me some insight and some perspective that I started looking at a little different.
It's just that you really, like, you can't know yourself. Like, right now, if I told somebody I know who I am, then I'd be limiting myself to being just this.
Mm-hmm.
54, this is where I limit myself to. This is where I know. I know myself at 54 that I know nothing.
Mm-hmm.
54, if I know who I am, then I'm such a limited motherfucker. Then I shouldn't even be living.
Mm.
Every day, life is about change. Next month, you'll be different than you are today.
No question. Tomorrow.
Tomorrow, you'll be different than you are today. Well, you know, thinking, man. But tomorrow, you won't be the same. No 2 days are the same. Isn't that something? Just as we're talking right now, every tenth of a minute of a second, we're dying. But we don't. But we're not tripping on it because we still feel good.
But we're you feel good? You feel good?
I feel awesome. Never felt this good in my life. Just physically, now, but as far as look, my outlook on life is awesome.
Okay, so let's go into I'm back. What does that mean? I see the physical transformation, but what does that mean? I'm back.
that don't really mean nothing. You know, that just means I'm here.
You said it. You said it. You said it, like, intently in the camera.
Yeah. I'm here. And I'm capable of doing that, too.
Mm-hmm.
That's just a scenario you're saying. I'm in a different field of life, in a different frame of thinking.
Got it. You embarked on acting a few years back, and you've been doing it. What is your affinity for acting?
Hey, you know, I used to like, what I really like, too, I used to like entertaining people.
Hmm. Just another form.
I used to like entertaining people. Ever since Nick does, him explaining about if you do this, how many people will love you, and I got caught up with that. I got caught up with myself and my world, my parents, how many people know me, and I'm sure no one could ever believe I did this. Then, listen, right? I always felt I was the worst guy in the world. I had no money. But my mother and father had a great life. I pretty much had a great life. I was cussing them. I was just had a great life. I had a great life. Everybody in the town knew me. Everybody in the country knew me. I had a new car. I couldn't even drive. I didn't have a license. I guess, and cussing them just spoiled me. Maybe I wasn't good. I knew what it was like. You know what I knew? I knew what it was like when those white guys had a father and they made their father proud. So I made him very proud. You know how I made him proud? By breaking people's ribs, breaking people's ribs, breaking their eye socket. That made him very happy. So I like making him happy. So I continue to do that. And it got me.
So you said you like making people happy?
Yeah, because I thought, look, one day I hit a guy and I think I broke his eye socket, and it really wasn't, it was a nice guy. And I felt bad. And then Cuz told me, and he explained, but it was really, he said it in a classy way, but I'm going to do it in my way.
Mm.
And he said, you continue to do that, and people will love you for it.
Wow. RJ, go ahead. Finish your statement.
No, go ahead. Say it again. He said this. What? He would be a foreign language to you if you listen to me.
Hmm.
And then I got turned out by him. I became a slave. And that way that I would do anything that he told me. If he told me to kill somebody, I would kill somebody. I put my head in that frame of mind. I want to be champion. I want to be everything this guy's talking about. I want to be known forever. And then I started reading books about fighting.
What did Koss say to you that made you like, okay, I'm going to listen to everything this man says to me? What was it? What was that thing? What was that defining moment that connected with you? Like, I'm going to submit.
He said, if you listen to me, you'd be the greatest fighter in the world. You'd be the youngest champ ever.
And that was it.
Yeah. He said, listen. I used to always complain and cry because I didn't have girlfriends and stuff. He said, you listen to me, I'm going to have to buy you a bat to beat them off you. And he's right. I never had a girlfriend. I was always crying and stuff. He said, just listen to me, son, and you trust me. I'm going to buy you a bat to beat him off you. He's right.
God. Mm-mm-mm-mm. So now, you were robbing people.
I never forgot this. Confidence applied properly will supersede a genius. I never forgot that.
Right.
Confidence. Right. This world was created off of confidence.
Mm.
Alexander the Great created his world for the greatest conqueror of all time. And it may not have been true, but he showed it.
Mm.
And listen, be honest, he's not the greatest conqueror of all time, but everybody thinks he is.
Right. What do you think?
Huh?
What do you think?
He's not the greatest conqueror. He didn't conquer more than his tongue.
Hmm?
But he was more charismatic.
Got it.
He's very charismatic.
Do you feel like you have like major charisma? You felt like that because you have a magnetic draw, still today.
Hey, I'm very grateful, and I don't take myself serious. I don't get embarrassed and stuff like that.
Mm.
And I won't let nobody embarrass me. I just don't get embarrassed because nowhere I know that from 10 minutes from now to probably 30 years from now, I won't exist anymore.
But your legacy will live on.
Excuse me?
Your legacy will live on.
Legacy don't mean anything.
Nothing.
Just being known. If you know me, you know? Just like I searched those other fighters up, and no one knew who they were, people would do that about me. Listen, right? This is so funny. It was this guy named Ballard Nelson. He fought in like 19... He started fighting 1990, but he hit his prime in 1903, 4, 5, 08, and 10. But I saw him fight a guy he knocked out named Howard Haler, 1910 sometime. He knocked him out, and he put his hands on his waist. So when I knocked out Larry Holmes, I put my arms on my hands on my waist like Ballard Nelson.
You did?
Told the people, I showed them, I did that because I saw Ballard Nelson do that.
Wow.
Lady that was 80 years old came to me and said, this guy that knocked Ballard Nelson knocked out her father. She wanted me to sign it. She heard me say that, and she came. I don't know where this old lady was from. She came all the way to Las Vegas. She couldn't get in the fight, but she came to meet me, and she did. And I signed the thing. And she said, that's my father. When he was doing like Ballard Nelson, that was my father that he knocked out. And she came. She's an old lady, like 75.
Mm. So, Mike, you were robbing people at an alarming number growing up, right?
Yeah.
But then, every time I've ever seen you, you were always giving of yourself. In every which way, you were always very, even at the height, I'm talking about like in terms of, I guess, when you say ego, I've always seen you be very giving. How did that, it was such a contrast.
I heard my mother was like that. Maybe it's genetics. I don't know. I just, to somebody.
I remember you came to Philly, huh?
Gave it to me. Cousin them gave me the knowledge. He didn't charge me a penny. Who do you?
I can't hear you.
You hear me now?
I can hear you now. Okay.
I said cousin them taught me that for nothing. They trained me for nothing. I didn't pay to get trained.
Wow. Paid nothing, but then
Cuss was a communist guy, socialist guy. He gave everything he had away. He had me think that he brought his, he got his money, stole people, stole his money. But he gave all, I found out he gave all his fucking money away. He's a communist guy, socialist. He gave all his money away.
But Mike, you would do, I'm saying, listen to me, I would be around you and you would have thousands of thousands, I'm talking about cash on you, and you, yeah, would give, you would give it away. I remember you came to Philly one time. I asked you to come to Philly. You came to Philly, and I guess you got lost out in the plateau, but you went to go get something to eat, right? The girl hit me up and said, Mike just gave me a $1,000 tip.
Well, I got it. If I got it, I could do it.
But most people that have it don't want to give it up because they didn't have it.
Well, that's just how I am. Listen, know what's so funny? I don't know if it's my ego. I always had money. Even when I was in the street, I just always had it. Even when guys used to pick on me and rob me, they always robbed me for a lot of money. I always had money.
Wow.
I was constantly robbing people, robbing houses. Listen, I'm 10 years old, 11 years old. I'm going in houses, I'm getting 15,000, I'm getting a machine gun, I'm getting 45. Listen, man, can you imagine that? Can you imagine being, I'm 11 years old and got $30,000 and got a fucking machine gun, got some 45? Can you imagine that?
Mm. That's like 15 million to you.
Yeah, well, listen, I got guns, nigga. I'll kill somebody. Robbing somebody's house, they got guns in there. Man, it's crazy being in somebody's house. And they're in there, you don't know it. But they're in there and you don't know it.
No, and you're going to get machine guns. You're going to get guns out of a place.
Yeah, and the guy.
Hope that he ain't standing at the top of the step waiting for you.
No, he's in the bed sleeping. He's talking. He's thinking I'm somebody else. Honey, you there? What you doing, baby? And I'm, whoa! I knocked on the door. No one answered. I've been knocking on the door. I said, no one's there. I went in there. He's sleeping. He's dead, baby. You get something, you got something. I'm like, oh shit, and I'm walking out. And, oh man.
Wow. Tell me about Jack Dempsey.
Somebody out. You know, that's part too.
You said what?
I had a couple of friends that got killed going in somebody's house.
That's the probability is high.
Yeah, real high. But the rewards is really high too.
It's not, though. Huh? Not in your life. It's a perception that it is.
Check it out, Charlie, right? In Brownsville, if you ain't hustling, you don't got no money, you're going to die anyway. You're going to become. You're not hustling. You're a victim. Ain't that something? You could be going to school, be the nice guy, but you're a victim because you're not robbing and stealing. You're in Philly, man. If you're not doing this, you're the other team. You're on the other side.
This is true. A question came in from RJ. He said, tell the story of how y'all met. You and Rodney Jerkins.
Listen, I decided to do a music company, right? I'm talking to Devante, and somebody said, do a music company. I said, okay, who do we go to? And then someone told me the baddest guy of this young guy's teenage name is Rodney Jergen. He's in Jersey. He lives by Atlantic City. So the first thing I did, I called them up and said, hey, we need you, buddy. Let's do this and that.
We need you, buddy.
And we've been friends ever since.
You got him in shape, too. You with him in shape. How was he?
Rodney, he's like, if not my best friend, he's like one of my best friends in the world.
Hey, listen, we love him. Don't we love him?
Oh, he's the best.
We love him. We absolutely love him. Tupac, tell me about your relationship with Tupac.
Listen, I met Tupac one day. It was a club happening in the Palladium on Sunset. They didn't want to let him in. And the guy that was blocking the door was holding the party. He was a very close friend of mine. But he was very close. And I said, what's up? He said, man, he can go in, Mike. He let him in. He grabbed the mic, started rhyming. And then I met him. And then when I went to prison, he wrote me a letter. And then he came the next week. And he came around three times to visit me.
It's crazy because I remember when you went to jail. I think I spoke to you the morning that you – I believe I spoke to you the morning that you were actually going to court when they sent you, right?
Yeah.
And then I spoke to you probably about – I'm going to say I probably spoke to you a year later. I have been writing you. You was like, no, I received your letters. You know what I mean? He's like, but listen, hold on. I got to go check this dude for my cigarettes. I was like, Mike, what are you doing? He said, I'm in jail, man. I got to handle my business, man.
You can't believe what I had to go through in this place, right?
How was that experience in jail? Honestly – you walk in there the first day. The whole jail got to be, like, you got to disrupt the whole place.
The place was so happy I was in there. Oh, man. So I go into my cell. I'm mad. I go in my cell. I close the cell door. And this white guy said, no, come on out here. Hey, man. Hey, come out here. You need to be out. We need to see you. We love you and all that shit. Oh, man. And, yeah, it was just a lot of love. Too much love. And, you know, too much love is not good for you either. And you learn that when you're in rehab and you read the big book. And the quickest form of relapse is the lack of love and too much love. Isn't that stupid? Mm. Hey, we have
too much love.
Too much love. Because too much love is everything I do is good, be bad. That's what you think. Nobody's unhappy. Everybody's sad. I'm happy, but everybody's sad. When I'm not doing it, everybody's happy and I'm sad.
You did the same thing, I think, in jail.
Not true. I don't think you know. You know I was Muslim before I went in prison.
No, no. I'm saying, that's people's perception. I know that. I'm saying people's perception is that you found a lot in jail, but that didn't happen. Go ahead.
Sound good for the books and the paper, so I let them go with it. But that's not true.
So again, correct it. Let the folks know, let the brothers and sisters know, when did that actually happen for you?
Listen, I was Muslim before I went there. I was always, my chauffeur was Captain Joe, Yusuf Shah. Yusuf Shah, he was down, he was the minister before Malcolm was.
Mm-hmm.
So, and he used to be my driver, and he would educate me every day, every second of the week, and every time he would drive me. You know?
What was it about Islam that drew you in? What was it about the religion that drew you?
That's just who I am.
Right.
And the person, it's just mm-hmm. who it influences.
You coming out of jail that night, I'm watching you coming out. You're in a place of, now were you in a place of peace? It seemed like you were very much so, you were centered. It seemed like you were.
I wasn't centered, I wanted revenge. I came out of prison with the wrong frame of mind.
Wow.
That's why I went back. I came out with a bad frame of mind. I came out for revenge. I thought
revenge on who?
Exactly. Who? Me. I made this up. I made all that up in my head in prison, feeling sorry for myself. He's against me. She's against me. I'm going to kill him. I'm going to kill that bitch. I'm going to do That's what it was.
So you were very much so infuriated, and you wanted to make people pay.
Yeah, because I don't think I should have been in there.
Listen. I'll tell you. I'm here to say it myself. The least thing. Again, listen. No knock to any female ever, and I hope that I'm saying that I can actually say this because I'm going to say it. Mike Tyson don't need to violate any woman at any point, any time. Literally.
But dig, right?
I would speak to that. You don't have to say it. I'll speak to that.
All right, no, but I want you to know this, nigga. I'm not above violating a woman, right? But I didn't violate that woman. That's just keeping it real. Just keeping it real. Especially back then. Back then, I wasn't above violating, taking no pussy and stuff, but I didn't take cuz.
Are you mad at her?
No way. That was a favor. That was a big blessing for me.
A big blessing?
Yes. Listen, I look at life totally different. Yeah, I used to look at some people as my nigga, my player, my homeboy, my bitch, my hoe. And now I look at them all as my teachers. I don't look at them. I look at them in a totally different perspective. I have no.
Have you seen her? Have you seen her?
No, I don't see her. I wouldn't know what she looked like if I saw her.
If she walked up to you and say, my name is Desiree, she don't need to say last name. What would be your response?
Nothing. I was, how you doing? I don't even know her no more. I don't even have that connection with her no more. I don't. Mm-hmm. It's like it's never happened.
How about she wanted to sit down with you?
Huh?
How about if she wanted to sit down with you?
I'm not interested in doing that.
Okay.
No, she didn't do. She did the wrong thing. I'm not interested. I'm over that. I'm doing this now. Mm-hmm. This is so much bigger than anything I ever experienced in my life.
So you would just be a gentleman and say, have a nice day. Couldn't go no further.
I don't know if I'm a gentleman like that, but, you know, it wouldn't be no static.
Mm-hmm. Got it.
I think I'm above calling her bitches and hoes now. You know,
how'd you get there?
I don't go that way, huh?
How'd you get there?
I don't know. I just don't know. You know, I just don't want to go that route anymore. Because I've done it already.
Are you concerned the way your daughters view you and your sons? I'm saying in terms of the way that you, I guess, your walk. You know what I mean?
I don't know. They have to deal with who I am. And then I have to tell their friends and their daughters and their kids my father was like this. My father did this for me. They got to say, my father sent me to school. My father bought me this house. My father left me all this money when he died. That's what they're going to tell their friend. My father was a bum. He's no good, but he made sure I had this house. He was rotten, but he made sure my kids went to school in this nice school. But he was a bum. He did nothing but work all day. He didn't talk to my mother that much. They argued a bunch. But, you know, I still got this big inheritance that he sent me for my kids and my brothers and sisters over here. So maybe it's gonna be something like that. The conversation will be like that.
I think that, and what I've known, kids don't necessarily. I think it all becomes relative. Like, so your younger kids grew up, they're growing up in an environment that becomes their reality. So you growing up in Brownsville in a project housing.
No, I didn't have. I wasn't that good. I lived in slums. I wasn't in.
Okay, so slums. So
I never lived. Slums. Listen, being in a project was, man. I would love to have lived in the projects.
Okay. So wherever you live, living in the slums and them living the way they living, to me it's all relative. I remember asking Will one time, did he think that Willow and Jaden understood that, you know, the square footage they live in versus, oh, wait a minute. Mike. Wi-Fi, you back?
And I'm back, man.
I gonna keep it. How much time you got? Because I wanna. I can talk to you forever. How much time you have, Mike? Wi-Fi. Mike left. That Wi-Fi is vicious. Again, Monday. I know, right? I know. Monday, Kobe Cole, Brooke Payne, and Cool from Cool in the Gang. And then Wednesday, DJ Judge Jeff and Will Smith. I want to hear Fresh Prince. DJ Judge Jeff and Fresh Prince, and then Will Smith. And then Friday, we got CeCe Peniston. We got CeCe Peniston, we have Tank, and we got my girl, Mickey Howard. Brownsville in the building, of course. Where you at? Where you at, Mike? Where you at? Where you at? Is Mike back on? Is Mike back on? Let's see if he's back on. Is Mike back on? Is he back on? That Wi-Fi is crazy. Just got a few more. What up? What up, Columbus Short? What's happening? I need you to come on. I definitely want you to come on. DM me your number. Hey, Columbus, DM me your number. I'll call you, set it up for sure. Where's Mike at? That Wi-Fi is vicious. Here we go. Here he is. I don't want to keep my brother too long, but I can talk to him forever. So, you know, it's endless. I haven't even got through half of the questions I want to ask him, but, you know. Mike.
What?
How much time you got?
See, my masseuse just came in, so I got a few minutes.
So you got a few. So number 20?
Yeah.
Number 20. I put it. Okay, cool. So, wow, man. It's my head is spinning. I got many questions, brother. Jack Dempsey.
Yeah.
Tell me about Jack Dempsey.
Hobo. Very poor, from Colorado. Mm-hmm. Became the first $1 million fighter.
Mm.
Aggressive, really savage mentality. So people loved that. It was a different time. Racism was at a height. At the time Jack Dempsey was fighting, there was more Ku Klux Klan members than there's ever been in history.
You said more.
Yeah, more members than the Ku Klux Klan.
That Wi-Fi is mean, Mike. Huh? Yeah.
Funny, it was the biggest moment of the Ku Klux Klan, and that was the time Dempsey was fighting.
Sugar Ray Robinson.
Poetry in motion, baby.
Poetry in motion. What was his strengths? What was his weaknesses?
And listen, right? His strength was with Muhammad. He has total supreme confidence in himself. Fast hand, vicious puncher, never give up, fight to the finish, fight every second of the fight, and just had extreme confidence to know he was the best fighter that God created.
Mm. Jack Johnson.
He was our first. He was our first, and he showed his character and dignity, too.
He fought 100 rounds, I think, or 90 rounds or something like that. How many rounds did he fight?
A 45-rounder, and he got stopped in the 16th round. 26.
Would you have wanted to fight in that time in that many rounds? Would you want it? Although, huh?
I knocked everybody out in one round.
They said get 2,000 rounds. It wouldn't matter. You're going to get them out of the first round.
And move their head back then.
Hey, Mike, you know you owe a lot of people money, right?
Why is that?
Dude, I'm saying the consumer will purchase their tickets and they get to the building and the fight is already over.
I gave them that money.
Huh? Huh?
They don't want to let them see me, and that's what I did. They just wanted to see me. That's
no, I'm saying people still in line trying to get in. The fight is already over.
Hey, they had the opportunity to be in the same room, moment in the same space.
Hey, listen, man, it's a beautiful, beautiful thing, brother. Beautiful thing. Beautiful. Beautiful.
I think the beautiful thing is really like a joke. You know, I really understand Allah put me in this position and I'm really nobody.
So you know there's an urban legend. I hate to talk about it, but I got to do it because people have, they've dogged me out about it so much. So I got to talk about it because I'm a real dude. We real dudes. So people knew my relationship with you, right? So the day you fought Holyfield, I was running late. I came in the building, the back steps. The fight was over. Now, mind you, I've known Holyfield from Meldrum, right? Unbeknownst to me, the fight is over. I walk down the steps. Literally, as soon as I come down the steps, Holyfield is coming there. And he stops to have a conversation with me. They think that I actually went in with you and went out with Holyfield. Can you please tell them that wasn't the case?
I don't know. I wasn't there, but you know, you gotta tell me.
No. What I'm saying is I didn't walk into the fight with you. Let them know that I didn't walk into the fight with you, please.
You didn't. I don't know, but you didn't. Then I don't remember that shit, Charlie.
No. I'm just saying people always would like. Listen, whenever they show that fight, they always show that at the end. They was like, Charlie walked in with Mike and left out with Holyfield. I'm like, no, I didn't. I didn't. I just was running late.
I don't know, Charlie. Charlie, think about this. What do you like, Charlie? What do you care about what somebody
huh? thinks
that you want?
No, no, no. Listen, there's an urban kind of fun legend. That's all. I'm not tripping on that. Not even a little bit.
And about that, Charlie.
We're just on here, so I figure I'd address it. You there? How did you go about discovering and starting business ventures in the cannabis industry? How'd they come about?
Listen, you want to know this shit? Listen, I had no idea. I never did this, never wanted to do this. And I was doing a movie in Thailand. Whatever, producing a movie, heard my brother-in-law's pitch about the cannabis business. And they thought about going full out. They thought it was a good idea. They thought I was a good candidate. Listen, nobody was going to touch me with a million-foot pole as far as advertisements and all that back then, right? And so these guys told me, hey, listen, Mike, would you be interested in going back where you were before and being a big superstar and all that stuff? Would you got to promote this and we want to go into business with you, this and that? And then this happened. I come to the office. I wasn't taking it serious. These white guys, I'm going to get some money and then we move on to the next scheme or something. And so my wife must have been talking about something that I've been doing, shit, probably fucking with women and probably spending too much money and going out too much. And so they set me up. I was doing this show. Okay. I was doing this show. You were staying here with me, baby, when they do it? Right, so he was doing the show. How you doing, man? And they said, do the toad. I got this medicine that can make you see God, and it's the God monocle. I'm listening to this guy, and I'm high on cocaine right now. I'm saying, what shit you talking about? Nigga, you don't got nothing that I can't see, man. I've been under all the drugs. I've been under this and that, and my meth. And so I said, give it to me. He said, no, this is not like that. This, you got to lay down. You got to do a ceremony. You got to ask God for permission. I'm like, oh, God. So I go there. And you're not going to believe this. Smoke it and listen. My spirit went here, my body went here. And I went some places, and man, listen, my whole life changed. I haven't did cocaine in 2 years. I haven't did nothing that I don't know what's going on. None of the good stuff is happening.
Is this the toad or is this weed?
No, it's the toad. Nigga, weed is just for me. My personal use. The toad is, ooh, boy, the toad is.
Change your life.
Yeah, I can say that. But listen, how could a guy come? Listen, I just had a fucking. I was overdose. I was fat. I was 100 pounds, 85 pounds overweight. How do I do the toad? The next thing you know, I'm 220 pounds. I'm ripped. And I'm talking about boxing exhibition. Everybody wants to see. Everybody's offering all these fucking millions, 110th of millions of dollars to see me in the fucking. We have to see my old ass. Listen, remember I did that little bullshit shadow boxing in the. I fucking was a little bit of an asshole, and he tried to protect me ever since. He was right. He tried to protect me ever since the day. Everything, he always tried to protect me. And by sometimes, I realized, like a parent does, and Cuss always said this about his parents, sometimes out of love, they smothered you. And that's probably what he did a little. Nobody around me, like, convinced him. I didn't understand. I don't want to stay here with my family. I didn't want to. He was so strange. His wife, all his fighters left him for like that, all that stuff. But I didn't even want to fight. I just wanted to stay around them. I had a family. I'm a sewage nigga. Man. I'm a sewage. Now I got these white people loving me. And not only that, I got these white people making these other white people respect me.
Yeah, I'm going to ask you. I want to ask you about that too. I want to know, I'm going to put you in a car seat. And you got a young fighter like yourself, 15 years old. And he's coming from the inner city of Brooklyn, and he's just not cultivated anything. But he, Rodney Jerkins is on here too. Rodney's on as well. But listen, Rodney, that's my brother as well. But I'm saying, so I'm putting you in that seat, in the car seat. I know that he insulated you. He wouldn't let nobody bother you. He would pretty much let you do and run how you wanted to run. Would you do the same thing? in that seat with Cos?
Well, I can't do it like, because, listen, Cos is a very rare gem. People can't like him. How come everybody that associate with Cos, Cos could tell them to kill somebody and they'll do it? Cos is deep on controlling the mind of people. Giving them an insight on some control. Cos is the kind of guy like this. Listen, right? Normally a guy goes like this. You see a weak guy, fuck that nigga. Let me take it. And Cos see a weak guy, Cos says, let me make him strong.
Mmm.
I see a weak guy. He see him. It's strange like that.
Mmm. So Mike Tyson, if you were sitting in the car seat, Mike Tyson couldn't come. He would be going out to gym the first weekend.
Listen, I'm different. I'll probably be into my own head. I got an ego. I ain't gonna let somebody talk to me a certain way. I'm not gonna let somebody act a certain way and stuff. But Cus was just, he's a master at what he do. That's why I succeeded in what I did, because he was a master. Not necessarily because of my skill and stuff, but because what he gave me the confidence. And what I learned about confidence is this. Confidence applied properly will supersede a genius. A genius won't have a match for him. Nothing more strong than confidence. Too confident.
So you don't think that could actually, you don't think ego could actually supersede that?
No, because the confidence creates the ego.
And you told me that was the thing that you actually welcomed. You welcomed the biggest ego in the room.
Absolutely, because it's not the biggest ego, but it's the control of the biggest ego, the master.
Wow.
Everybody can't control it.
So, okay, so now Cos transitions. You actually now are getting trainers that don't understand that teaching, that numbers system. How did you even allow them to come into your environment?
I don't know. I had Don King. I was confused. Everybody that was on my team was trying to betray me. Hey, listen, nigga.
Were you aware of it at the present time? At the present?
I don't know what I was aware of. I was aware of myself. I was aware of me. That's what you do when you're 19 years old with a lot of fucking money and never had it before. You're conscious of you, your material world, and your dick. So I had all the material and all the pussy that I wanted.
Oof.
But I didn't have no security for my future. I couldn't even fuck the bitches that I used to fuck, and I had no money.
So you think money was the thing that drew them to you, not you?
No, it had to be money, yeah. I made sure it was that.
You said you made sure.
I want them fucking people to know me. You think I want them to know my dark ass and never talk to me again? Fucking.
Wow. That's pretty amazing right there. Wow. Sheesh. Your style, angles, switching stances. You know what I mean? I noticed that you always did something. You would hit a guy to the body and then you go uppercut. Why wouldn't you just go uppercut? Why'd you go to the body first?
The uppercut is the most underestimated punch, and it's the most unexpected punch.
I noticed you would switch. You would switch to the right side, switch to the left side. You deliver a punch, and then you would kind of switch over. What was that about? Tell me about that.
Listen, the art of the knockout, right? The art of the knockout is not seeing the punch. So the name of the game is trying to persuade the guy to believe something's happening that's not actually happening. Punch where he don't.
Wow, you said the art. I didn't hear your whole thought. What did you just say?
Part of knocking people out is hitting them with punches they don't see.
Got it. Now I see your son. I seen you working your son out. He looks like he has the natural skill set. Is that correct?
He's scholastic. He's an awesome kid. He does. He's a straight A student.
But he looked like he was sitting on those punches.
What is his IQ, Miguel? He's like one of the highest IQs out there, right, baby? GPA. His GPA. You know what that is?
Yes, absolutely.
It's off the hook.
But I'm saying again, he could be an astute, gentleman. But at the same time, he could be a skilled boxer as well. And he looked like he got it.
This is what I found out about people, right? And I don't like to say it about myself. Listen, you see how great Muhammad Ali is?
Mm-hmm.
Forget his kids, his bloodline. There's nobody that on this planet that's going to be like him. So how you think his bloodline, they're going to be like him? There's nobody on the planet. It has nothing to do. He had nothing to do with bloodline. He was created by the gods of war. He has nothing to do with bloodline.
Mm. So you don't think lightning can strike again?
Huh?
You don't think lightning can strike again? You don't think it can happen again?
Muhammad Ali lightning? Muhammad Ali? No.
Really?
Listen, you won't see it in your lifetime. I won't see it in my.
Right. Wow. That's amazing. What drove you too much to master your craft? Huh?
Excuse me? Say it again.
I said, what drove you to master your craft?
Insecurity.
What kept your eye on it?
Insecurity, poverty. I don't want to. I want my family to be proud of me. When I was fighting, I started. My mother was alive, but when my mother died, right, I used to make cuffs. She's been to court back and forth all my life. I've been locked up. I've been like, she's been dealing with that. She never saw anything good with me. All her friends said, I'm going to die. Your son is no good. He's this and that. I robbed her friends. You know, I'm the nigga that, when my mother and her friend downstairs drinking, in my back of my room, I'm going to escalate the fight. I go up into their house, rob that, wipe them out, everything. They go upstairs after drinking, come down, Lord, and they took it all. Lord, they took the food. I was that way. I wanted to be down with the street hoodlum. And I was a criminal. I would have boyfriends come in. She'd have a date come in. And after they finish doing whatever they do, he'd be wiped out sleeping. I'd go in his, cut his pocket, wipe him off, take his watch, his jewelry. He'd get up, probably beat my mother's ass, but I got the money. That's what my whole life was about, hustling, getting money, robbing houses, snatching chains, snatching people's pockets out. That was my before I got involved with fighting. I was just a criminal. My whole life was going to be a criminal. And I was going to rob people. I was going to set people up. Maybe kill them.
Well, okay. So now, I don't think money suppresses that. It's a mentality. How did you suppress it?
I guess at one time, stealing was my life. Robbing and stealing was my life. And now I have tried to do that.
Now that's what?
Shameful to me now. I have too much pride to steal now.
Got it. They say experience is the best teacher. What have you learned today that you wish you knew when you was 19 or 21?
Excuse me?
I said they say experience is the best teacher. What have you obtained today in your life that you wish you would have told your 19, 21-year-old self?
Well, what I would have told my 20-year-old that what you're experiencing now is just a moment in time. It's going to be better.
Gonna be so much better. Would you have told you relax? Take it in? Would you have told yourself relax, take it in? It's gonna be fine?
No, I would tell myself this. You know, from a guy like me, I read a lot because I have I never gone to school, so I read a lot and I became kind of worldly and I know and somewhere in Tibet, right? There's a whole bunch of monks that live there. A bunch of them, right? Probably 100. But all of them having this in their hut. They have a skeleton head to keep them conscious that, and you know when you see a skeleton head, the skeleton head has always got the big smile, right? Are you familiar with that?
Yes, sir.
But all of them have a skeleton head in their tut to let them know life is a joke.
Mm.
We're over, we're going to be a skeleton head, and we're going to have a big smile on our face. I don't think, I don't expect anything. I wanted to tell you, that's why I don't get disappointed anymore. Because I don't expect anything.
You said anymore?
Yeah. Because I saw the poorest people in the world, but they were so happy. They couldn't, they're so poor they can't, they have no liquid in their body to cry. They cry as Christians, right? But why are they happy? They don't expect shit. A guy like me expects everything. Just in case I do something, I expect $1 million to do this. And there's nothing here to do this. I want $1 million. What a prick I am. So you know what I mean? So I just look at stuff. I don't expect anything. It's on, I don't wow. Manage me, but I don't expect shit.
Wow. Wow.
I got a better relationship with my wife. Listen, if I see my wife talking to a guy that I don't know that well, and they talk like they had a relationship in the past, I don't say shit, nigga, because the only one's going to be upset is me. I don't say shit. My whole job is to keep my side of the street. I love my wife to death, die for it, all that bullshit fight, but, you know, I ain't going to get into a business no more. I ain't going to do that no more.
You said no more.
Yeah. I used to be stalking husbands and shit, not no more. Fuck that shit, nigga. Only one's going to me.
Wow.
He's wow. She's laughing at me, but she, you know, I'm going nuts. I don't get in nobody's business no more, right?
But you said nobody's business. Y'all are one. You said nobody's business.
We are one. See, Charlie. Her being my wife and me being her husband, that's our identification. That's our identification to the world, who we are. Mm-hmm. Now that we have that, though, that to the world that this is we're wife and husband, now we have our life to settle and get to become appropriate. And that's a lot of work. And so from now to 11 years, I don't think this will last the first year. So we made so much progress within that 1 year.
What were the tools that you used to get there? How'd you get there?
With a bad memory.
You said bad memory. Elaborate.
I don't sweat the small things.
Got it.
I don't sweat nothing. I don't sweat a path. I don't sweat nothing.
Got it.
Well, it is me, because I'm talking to them there. When you get an interview with somebody, you can tell them that. You know. See, they're always on me. They listen to me, what I'm saying. But I love her, and I let her do that, because I can't win this.
How did fatherhood impact your life, not having your father around you?
I don't know. I don't know nothing about fatherhood. I just do it. You know what I mean?
Do it?
There's no particular way I have to father. If my kids are out of line, I tell them they're out of line. Mm-hmm. And when I'm out of line, they tell me I'm out of line. We got a good relationship. There's no beatings. No beatings like me. Like I got so many beatings. I got beaten almost every day.
Mm.
They don't know. And if my kids never complain about me, I thought you had my father for a while. You have something to complain about.
Right.
I'm with them every day. My father was not here. I saw my father wasn't here. But when I saw him, I was so happy to.
Wow.
From my mother. That was. So I became like my father until I grew up. My father never grew up. Different thing that I grew up.
You think that it was because of your exposure, the fact that you were able to see something outside of the, you know, the four corners of your block?
Yeah, right. My father and my mother were fly when they, you know, they hung out with Malcolm, Miles Davis, all those fly guys from the swing era, 40s and 50s and 60s and 70s, and then she died in 82. They were ballers. They were playing. My grandfather had money in the States and stuff. They were having a really good time. If I send you a picture of my mother, you know she had money in her era.
Wow. What was your relationship with your mom?
Not good.
Why wasn't it?
My mother was like a borderline prostitute, and that didn't live well on me because she would do it in front of us. It was just that world, you know, and that's the world I come in with. So that's probably why I had my experience with women. That's why my experience with women was always bumped.
Right. Right. Yeah, I have a saying that your mother's the first woman you fall in love with or out of love with, as well as your father.
No, nigga. I married my wife because she got characteristics of my mother. That's what all men marry their mother.
Mm.
Even if they're not conscious of it. Even when they hate their mother, they marry their mother. That's the only woman they know about love from. So that's the only way they can perceive of love. It's from even that cranky-ass woman who they married.
Wow.
That's the wow. That's just really black, hate love, better love. That they fight all day, but they kill somebody else that'll fight against them. It's just really distorted love. Distorted shit.
So, Speaking of love, do you love Mike Tyson? You back?
You go.
I said, speaking of love, do you love Mike Tyson?
Hey, listen, right? Sometimes I have to break up with him. Because when I fall in love with him, I have no fucking competition.
That Wi-Fi is crazy, Mike. That Wi-Fi is crazy.
My love again?
I said, yes, I'm still on that. I'm saying that, still talking about you.
Tell me about me loving myself. What should I do? What characteristics show self love?
I think that you find out where your flaws are at, right? So you want to strengthen those, right? And in the areas that you're loving of people, you find out things that make you feel good, and you strengthen those as well. So you suppress the things that make you what you call an asshole, I guess. You know what I mean? Try to get, because I do what you call an evaluation on myself. I do an audit on myself every year around my birthday.
What do you call that, baby? Observation.
Well, I call it audit, right? So I do an audit. So what I look at, I evaluate. My birthday comes December 20th of each year. So around December 18th, I start evaluating my life. Who didn't matter to me? Who didn't I give my all to? If I gave one, like say I gave you 20%, I gave Will 80. I'm going to take the 20 from you and give Will that 20, give him 100. Because I'm wasting my time and your time. We're not able to benefit. People come into your life for two reasons. They come into a pact in a positive way or a negative way. There's only two things going to happen.
No, life, people come in your life because you want them in your life. You gave them messages to come in your life.
Mm-hmm. To impact it in two ways.
No, no, no. This is bigger than impact. You know, guys, when you see people...
That Wi-Fi, Mike.
Hey, listen, right?
Mm-hmm.
Now, when people come in your life, they come in your life sometimes because you're both looking for the same thing.
Mm-hmm.
Sex addicts or drug addicts or whatever. When they come in the room, they know who to, but they're looking for the same thing. They look out each other. They call each other from far distance. It's like telepathy. They call each other, and eventually they meet each other. That's how the world works. It doesn't work. They come in your life to hurt you. They come in your life, and then you make what happens out of it. Say they do something like steal money. It's up to you to say, I'm finished with that guy. Or say, hey, he's bigger than the money. Maybe we can understand it and show some compassion. I was made by this beat the fuck out of me, kill him. For what? I saw people kill people for less, but just that $1,000, like, affected me, violated me, he has to die. Because if he violates me, everybody's going to violate me. That's why he died. That's why most people in the street die, because you can't let nobody know that this guy violated me. And after this, you know, if he violated me, you see what happens.
Wow.
You from Philadelphia, buddy. I know they do the same thing down there.
Absolutely.
Absolutely.
Absolutely. Absolutely. But I would say to you, people are intrigued by what's going on, what makes Mike tick, what makes him happy and what ticks him off. They want to know that. Because, again, they're looking at it, you know what I mean, from a distance. They don't know. They want to know. What makes him have that time bomb, if you will? And how does he suppress that time bomb?
Big, right? My time bomb comes from my trauma. Things I've dealt with, what, sexual abuse, or just being beat up all the time. Or just watching your mother being beat, but watching your mother fuck all the time. So you get that trauma. So I look at life, my life is different. I look at life from a different eyes than probably you or other people.
Well, we've been talking, man, you've been talking, and you've been giving me some insight and some perspective that I started looking at a little different.
It's just that you really, like, you can't know yourself. Like, right now, if I told somebody I know who I am, then I'd be limiting myself to being just this.
Mm-hmm.
54, this is where I limit myself to. This is where I know. I know myself at 54 that I know nothing.
Mm.
54, if I know who I am, then I'm such a limited motherfucker. Then I shouldn't even be living.
Mm.
Every day, life is about change. Next month, you'll be different than you are today.
No question. Tomorrow.
Tomorrow you'll be different than you are today.
Tomorrow.
Well, you know, thinking, Ben. But tomorrow you won't be the same. No 2 days are the same. Isn't that something? Guess as we're talking right now, every tenth of a minute of a second we're dying. But we don't. But we're not tripping on it because we still feel good.
But we're you feel good? You feel good?
I feel awesome. Never felt this good in my life. Just physically, I'm sure now. But as far as look, my outlook on life is awesome.
Okay. So let's go into I'm back. What does that mean? I see the physical transformation, but what does that mean? I'm back.
That don't really mean nothing. You know, that just means I'm here.
You said it. You said it. You said it like intently in the camera.
Yeah. I'm here. And I'm capable of doing that too.
Mm-hmm. But
back, that's just a scenario you're saying I'm in a different field of life, in a different frame of thinking.
Got it. You embarked on acting a few years back and you've been doing it. What is your affinity for acting?
Hey, you know, I used to like what I really like too, I used to like entertaining people.
Just another form.
I used to like entertaining people. Ever since because him explaining about if you do this, how many people will love you. And I got caught up with that. I got caught up with myself and my world, my family, how many people know me, and I'm stupid. No one could ever believe I did this. And listen, right? I always felt I was the worst guy in the world. I had no money. But my mother and father had a great life with you. I pretty much had a great life. I was cussing them. I was just had a great life. I had a great life. Everybody in the town knew me. Everybody in the country knew me. I had a new car. I couldn't even drive. I didn't have a license. I guess and some of them just spoiled me. Maybe I wasn't good. I knew what it was like. You know what I knew? I knew what it was like when those white guys had a father and they made their father proud. So I made him very proud. You know how I made him proud? By breaking people's ribs, breaking people's ribs, breaking their eye socket. That made him very happy. So I like making him happy. So I continue to do that.
So you said you like making people happy?
Yeah, because I thought, look, one day I hit a guy, and I think I broke his eye socket, and he really wasn't saying he was a nice guy. And I felt bad. And then Cuz told me, and he explained, but it was really, he said it in a classy way, but I'm going to do it in my way. And he said, you continue to do that, and people will love you for it.
Wow. RJ, go ahead. Finish your statement.
No, go ahead. Say it again. He said this would be a foreign language to you if you listen to me.
And
I just got turned out by him. I became his slave. And that way that I would do anything that he told me. If he told me to kill somebody, I would kill somebody. I put my head in that frame of mind. I want to be champion. I want to be everything this guy's talking about. I want to be known forever. And then I started reading books about fighting.
What did Koss say to you that made you like, okay, I'm going to listen to everything this man says to me? What was it? What was that thing? What was that defining moment that connected with you? Like, I'm going to submit.
He said, if you listen to me, you'd be the greatest fighter in the world. You'd be the youngest champ ever.
And that was it.
Yeah. He said, listen. I used to always complain and cry because I didn't have girlfriends and stuff. He said, you listen to me, I'm going to have to buy you a bat to beat them off you. And he's right. I never had a girlfriend. I was always crying and stuff. He said, just listen to me, son. And you trust me, I'm going to buy you a bat to beat them off you. He's right.
God. So now, you were robbing people.
I just never forgot this. Confidence applied properly will supersede a genius. I never forgot that.
Right.
Confidence. Right. This world was created off of confidence. Alexander the Great created his world off of confidence, the greatest conqueror of all time. And it may not have been true, but he showed it. And listen, be honest, he's not the greatest conqueror of all time, but everybody thinks he is.
Right. What do you think?
Huh?
What do you think?
He's not the greatest conqueror. He didn't conquer more than his tongue. But he was more charismatic.
Got it.
He's very charismatic.
Do you feel like you have like major charisma? You felt like that because you have a magnetic draw, still today.
Hey, I'm very grateful, and I don't take myself serious. I don't get embarrassed and stuff like that. And I won't let nobody embarrass me. I just don't get embarrassed because I know that from 10 minutes from now to probably 30 years from now, I won't exist anymore.
But your legacy will live on.
Excuse me?
Your legacy will live on.
Legacy don't mean anything.
Nothing.
Just being known. If you know me, you know? Just like I searched those other fighters up and no one knew who they were, people do that about me. Listen, right? This is so funny. It was this guy named Ballard Nelson. He started fighting 1990, but he hit his prime in 1903, 4, 5, 08, and 10. But I saw him fight a guy he knocked out named Howard Cosell, 1910 sometime. He knocked him out, and he put his hands on his waist. So when I knocked out Larry Holmes, I put my arms and my hands on my waist like Ballard Nelson.
You did?
Showed the people. I showed them. I did that because I saw Ballard Nelson do that.
Wow.
Lady that was 80 years old came to me and said, this guy that knocked Ballard Nelson knocked out her father. She wanted me to sign it. She heard me say that, and she came. I don't know where this old lady was from. She came all the way to Las Vegas. She couldn't get in the fight, but she came to meet me, and she did. And I signed the thing. And she said, that's my father. When he was doing like Ballard Nelson, that was my father that he knocked out. And she came. She's an old lady, like 75.
So, Mike, you were robbing people at an alarming number growing up, right?
Yeah.
But then, every time I've ever seen you, you were always giving of yourself in every which way. You were always very, even at the height, I'm talking about like in terms of, I guess, when you say ego, I've always seen you be very giving. How did that, it was such a contrast.
I heard my mother was like that. Maybe it's genetics. I don't know. I just, to somebody.
I remember you came to Philly, huh?
Gave it to me. Cousin him gave me the knowledge. He didn't charge me a penny. Who do you?
I can't hear you.
You hear me now?
I can hear you now. Okay.
I said Cousin him taught me that for nothing. He trained me for nothing. I didn't pay to get trained.
Wow. Pay nothing, but then they.
Cuss was a communist guy, socialist guy. He gave everything he had away. He had me think that he brought his, he got his money, stole people, stole his money. But he gave all. I found that he gave all his fucking money away. He's a communist guy, socialist. He gave all his money away.
But Mike, you would do. I'm saying, listen to me. I would be around you, and you would have thousands of thousands. I'm talking about cash on you, and you would give. You would give it away. I remember you came to Philly. You came to Philly one time. I asked you to come to Philly. You came to Philly. And I guess you got lost out in the plateau, but you went to go get something to eat, right? The girl hit me up and said, Mike just gave me a $1,000 tip.
Well, I got it. If I got it, I could do it.
But most people that have it don't want to give it up because they didn't have it.
Well, that's just how I am. Listen, know what's so funny? I don't know if it's my ego. I always had money. Even when I was in the street, I just always had it. Even when guys used to pick on me and rob me, they always robbed me for a lot of money. I always had money. Wow. I was constantly robbing people, robbing houses. Listen, I'm 10 years old, 11 years old. I'm going in houses, I'm getting 15,000, I'm getting a machine gun, I'm getting 45. Listen, man, can you imagine that? Can you imagine being I'm 11 years old and got $30,000 and got a fucking machine gun, got some 45? Can you imagine that?
That's like 15 million to you.
Yeah, well, listen, I got guns, nigga. I'll kill somebody. Robbing somebody's house, they got guns in there. Man, it's crazy being in somebody's house. And they're in there, you don't know it. But they're in there and you don't know it.
No, and you're going to get machine guns. You're going to get guns out of a place.
Yeah, and the guy.
Hope that he ain't standing at the top of the step waiting for you.
No, he's in the bed sleeping. He's talking. He's thinking I'm somebody else. Honey, you there? What you doing, baby? And I'm whoa! I knocked on the door. No one answered. I've been knocking on the door. I said, no one's there. No one in there. He's sleeping. He's dead, baby. You get something, you got something. I'm like, oh shit, and I'm walking out. And, oh man.
Wow. See, wow. Wow. Tell me about Jack Dempsey.
My house. You know, that's part of it too.
You said what?
I had a couple of friends that got killed going in somebody's house.
The probability is high.
Yeah, real high. But the rewards is really high too.
It's not though. Huh? Not in your life. Not on your life. It's perception that it is.
Check it out, Charlie, right? In Brownsville, if you ain't hustling, you don't got no money, you're gonna die anyway. You're not hustling, you're a victim. Ain't that something? You could be going to school, be the nice guy, but you're a victim because you're not robbing and stealing. You're in Philly, man. If you're not doing this, you're the other team. You're on the other side.
This is true. A question came in from RJ. He said, tell the story of how y'all met, you and Rodney Jerkins.
Listen, I've decided to do a music company, right? I'm talking to Devontae, and somebody said, do a music company. I said, okay, who do we go to? And then someone told me the baddest guy of this young guy's teenage name is Rodney Jerkins. He's in Jersey. He lives by Atlantic City. So the first thing I did, I called them up and said, hey, we need you, buddy. Let's do this and that.
We need you, buddy.
And we've been friends ever since.
You got him in shape, too. You with him in shape.
He's like, if not my best friend, he's like one of my best friends in the world.
Hey, listen, we love him. Don't we love him?
Oh, he's the best.
We love him. Absolutely love him. Tupac, tell me about your relationship with Tupac.
Listen, I met Tupac one day. It was a club happening in the Palladium on Sunset. They didn't want to let him in. And the guy that was blocking the door was holding the party. He was a very close friend of mine. But he was very close. And I said, what's up? He said, man, he can go in, Mike. He let him in. He grabbed the mic, started rhyming. And then I met him. And then when I went to prison, he wrote me a letter. And then he came the next week. And he came around 3 times to visit me.
It's crazy because I remember when you went to jail. I think I spoke to you the morning that you – I believe I spoke to you the morning that you were actually going to court when they sent you, right? Yeah. And then I spoke to you probably about – I'm going to say I probably spoke to you a year later. I have been writing you. You was like, no, I received your letters. You know what I mean? He's like, but listen, hold on. I got to go check this dude for my cigarettes. I was like, Mike, what are you doing? He said, I'm in jail, man. I got to handle my business, man.
You can't believe what I had to go through in this place, right?
How was that experience in jail? Honestly – you walk in there the first day. The whole jail got to be, like, you got to disrupt the whole place.
The place was so happy I was in there. Oh, man. So I go into my cell. I'm mad. I go in my cell. I close the cell door. And this white guy said, no, come on out here. Hey, man. He's coming out here. You need to be out here. We need to see you. We love you and all that shit. Oh, man. And, yeah, it was just a lot of love. Too much love. And, you know, too much love is not good for you either. And you learn that when you're in rehab and you read the big book. And the quickest form of relapse is the lack of love and too much love. Isn't that stupid? Too much love. Because too much love is, if everything I do is good, how could that be bad? That's what you think as a junkie. If everybody loves me, why can't I do this? Because now I do this, now I don't feel everybody's unhappy. Everybody's sad. I'm happy, but everybody's sad. When I'm not doing it, everybody's happy and I'm sad.
So much like Malik El-Sabaj, Malcolm X incarcerated, he found Allah. You did the same thing, I think, in jail.
Not true. I didn't think you know that. You know I was Muslim before I went in prison.
No, no. I'm saying, I'm just, again, that's people's perception. I know that. I'm saying people's perception is that you found Allah in jail, but that didn't happen. Go ahead.
So, sound good for the books and the paper, so I let him go with it. But that's not true.
So again, correct it. Let the folks know, let the brothers and sisters know, when did that actually happen for you?
Listen, I was Muslim before I went there. I was always, my chauffeur was Captain Joe, Yusuf Shah. They started, they the one, he was down, he was the minister before Malcolm was.
Mm-hmm.
So, and he used to be my driver, and he would educate me every day, every second of the week, and every time he would drive me. You know?
What was it about Islam that drew you in? What was it about the religion that drew you?
That's just who I am.
Right.
As a person. It's just who it influences.
You coming out of jail that night, I'm watching you coming out. You're in a place of, now were you in a place of peace? It seemed like you were very much so, you were centered. It seemed like you were.
I wasn't centered, I wanted revenge. I came out of prison with the wrong frame of mind.
Wow.
That's why I went back. I came out with a bad frame of mind. I came out for revenge. I thought
revenge on who?
Exactly. Who? me. I made this up. I made all that up in my head in prison, feeling sorry for myself. He's against me. She's against me. I'm going to kill him. I'm going to kill that bitch. I'm going to do that. That's what it was.
So you were very much so infuriated, and you wanted to make people pay.
Yeah, because I don't think I should have been in there.
All right, listen. I'll tell you, I'm here to say it myself. The least thing, again, listen, no knock to any female ever. And I hope that I'm saying that I can actually say this, because I'm going to say it. Mike Tyson don't need to violate any woman at any point, any time. Literally.
But dig, right?
I would speak to that. You don't have to say it. I'll speak to that.
All right, no, but I want you to know this, nigga. I'm not above violating a woman, right? But I didn't violate that woman. That's just keeping it real. Especially back then. Back then, I wasn't above violating, taking no pussy and stuff, but I didn't take cuz.
Are you mad at her?
No way. That was a favor. That was a big blessing for me.
A big blessing?
Yes. Listen, I look at life totally different. Yeah, I used to look at some people as my nigga, my player, my homeboy, my bitch, my hoe. And now I look at them all as my teachers. I don't look at them. I look at them in a totally different perspective.
Have you seen her? Have you seen her?
No, I don't see her. I wouldn't know what she looked like if I saw her.
If she walked up to you and say, my name is Desiree, she don't need to say last name. What would be your response?
Nothing. I was, how you doing? I don't even know her no more. I don't even have that connection with her no more. I don't. Mm-hmm. It's like it's never happened.
How about if she wanted to sit down with you?
Huh?
How about if she wanted to sit down with you?
I'm not interested in doing that.
Okay.
No, she didn't do. She did the wrong thing. I'm not interested. I'm over that. I'm doing this now. Mm-hmm. This is so much bigger than anything I ever experienced in my life.
So you would just be a gentleman and say, "Have a nice day." Couldn't go no further.
I don't know if I'm a gentleman like that, but, you know, it wouldn't be no static.
Mm-hmm. Got it.
I think I'm above calling her bitches and hoes now. You know,
how'd you get there?
I don't go that way, huh?
How'd you get there?
I don't know. I just don't know. You know, I just don't want to go that route anymore. Because I've done it already.
Are you concerned the way your daughters view you? And your sons, I'm saying, in terms of the way that you... I guess your walk, you know what I mean?
I don't know. They have to deal with who I am. And then I have to tell their friends and their daughters and their kids, my father was like this. Mm. My father did this for me. They got to say, my father sent me to school. My father bought me this house. My father left me all this money when he died. That's what they're going to tell their friends. My father was a bum. He's no good, but he made sure I had this house. He was rotten, but he made sure my kids went to school in this nice school. But he was a bum. He did nothing but work all day. He didn't talk to my mother that much. They argued a bunch. But, you know, I still got this big inheritance that he sent me for my kids and my brothers and sisters over here. So maybe it's going to be something like that. The conversation will be like that.
I think that, and what I've known, kids don't necessarily, I think it all becomes relative. Like, so your younger kids grew up, they're growing up in an environment that becomes their reality. So you growing up in Brownsville, in a project housing.
No, I didn't have. I wasn't that good. I lived in slums. I wasn't in.
Okay, project. So slums. So I never lived. So slums.
Listen, being in a project was, man, I would have been. I would love to have lived in the projects.
Okay, so wherever you live, living in the slums and them living the way they live in, to me, it's all relative. Right. I remember asking Will one time, did he think that Willow and Jaden understood that, you know, the square footage they live in versus? Oh, wait a minute. Mike. Wi-Fi. You back?
I know I'm back, man.
I ain't gonna keep it. How much time you got? Because I can talk to you forever. How much time you have? Mike. Wi-Fi. Mike left. That Wi-Fi is vicious. Again, Monday. I know, right? I know. Monday, Kobe Cole, Brooke Payne, and Cool from Cool in the Gang. And then Wednesday, DJ Judge Jeff and Will Smith. I want to hear Fresh Prince. DJ Judge Jeff and Fresh Prince, and then Will Smith. And then Friday, we got CeCe Peniston. We got CeCe Peniston. We have Tank. And we got my girl, Mickey Howard. Brownsville in the building, of course. Where you at? Where you at? Where you at, Mike? Where you at? Where you at? Where you at? Where you at? Is Mike back on? Is Mike back on? Let's see if he's back on. Is Mike back on? Is he back on? That Wi-Fi is crazy. Just got a few more. What up? What up, Columbus Short? What's happening? I need you to come on. I definitely want you to come on. DM me your number. Hey, Columbus, DM me your number. I'll call you, set it up for sure. Where's Mike at? That Wi-Fi. The Wi-Fi is vicious. Here we go. Here he is. I don't want to keep my brother too long, but I can talk to him forever. So, you know, it's endless. I haven't even got through half of the questions I want to ask him, but, you know. Mike.
What?
How much time you got?
See, my masseuse just came in, so I got a few minutes.
So you got a few? So number 20?
Yeah.
Number 20. I put it. Okay, cool. So, wow, man, it's my head is spinning. I got many questions, brother. Jack Dempsey.
Yeah.
Tell me about Jack Dempsey.
Hobo, very poor, from Colorado. Mm-hmm. Became the first million-dollar fighter.
Mm.
Aggressive, really savage mentality. So people loved that. It was a different time. Racism was at a height. There was, at the time Jack Dempsey was fighting, there was more Ku Klux Klan members than ever been in history of America.
You said more.
Yeah. More members than the Ku Klux Klan.
That Wi-Fi is mean, Mike. Huh? Yeah.
Funny, it was the biggest moment of the Ku Klux Klan, and that was the time Dempsey was fighting.
Sugar Ray Robinson.
Poetry in motion, baby.
Poetry in motion. What was his strengths? What was his weaknesses?
And listen, right? His strength was with Muhammad. He has total supreme confidence in himself. Fast hands, vicious puncher, never give up, fight to the finish, fight every second of the fight, and just had extreme confidence to know he was the best fighter that God created.
Mm. Jack Johnson.
He was our first. He was our first, and he showed his character and dignity, too.
He fought 100 rounds, I think, or 90 rounds or something like that. How many rounds did he fight?
A 45-rounder, and he got stopped in the 16th round. 26, I'm sorry, 26.
Would you have wanted to fight in that time in that many rounds? Would you want it? Although, huh?
I knocked everybody out in one round.
They say get 2,000 rounds. It wouldn't matter. You're going to get them out of the first round.
And move their heads back then.
Hey, Mike, you know you owe a lot of people money, right?
Why is that?
Dude, I'm saying the consumer will purchase their tickets and they get to the building and the fight is already over.
I gave them that money.
Huh? Huh?
They don't want to let them see me, and that's what I did. They just wanted to see me. That's
no, all. I'm saying people still in line trying to get in. The fight is already over.
Hey. They had the opportunity to be in the same room, moment, in the same space.
Hey, listen, man. It's a beautiful, beautiful thing, brother. A beautiful thing. Beautiful. Thank beautiful.
Thank you, beautiful. Huh? Really like a joke. You know, I really understand. Allah put me in this position, and I'm really nobody.
So you know there's an urban legend. I hate to talk about it, but I got to do it because people have they've dogged me out about it so much. So I got to talk about it because I'm a real dude. We real dudes. So people knew my relationship with you, right? So the day you fought Holyfield, I was running late. I came in the building, the back steps. The fight was over. Now, mind you, I've known Holyfield from Meldrick, right? Unbeknownst to me, the fight is over. I walk down the steps. Literally, as soon as I come down the steps, Holyfield is coming there. And he stops to have a conversation with me. They think that I actually went in with you and went out with Holyfield. Can you please tell them that wasn't the case?
I don't know. I wasn't in there, but, you know, you got to tell
them. No. What I'm saying is I didn't walk into the fight with you. Let them know that I didn't walk into the fight with you, please.
You didn't? I don't know, but you didn't. Then I don't remember that shit, Charlie.
No. I'm just saying, people always would, like, listen, whenever they show that fight, they always show that at the end. They was like, Charlie walked in with Mike and left out with Holyfield. I'm like, no, I didn't. I just was running late.
I don't know, Charlie. Charlie, think about this. What do you like, Charlie? What do you care about what somebody thinks?
Huh? No. Listen, this is an urban kind of fun legend. That's all. I'm not tripping on that. Not even a little bit.
Hey, about that, Charlie.
We just on here, so I figure I'd address it. You there? How did you go about discovering and starting business ventures in the cannabis industry? How'd they come about?
Listen, you want to know this shit? Listen, I had no idea. I never did this, never wanted to do this. And I was doing a movie in Thailand, whatever. Producing a movie, heard my brother-in-law's pitch about the cannabis business. And they thought about going full out. They thought it was a good idea. They thought I was a good candidate. Listen, nobody was going to touch me with a million-foot pole as far as advertisements and all that back then, right? And so these guys told me, hey, listen, Mike, will you be interested in going back where you were before and being a big superstar and all that stuff? But you got to promote this and we want to go into business with you, this and that. And then this happened. I come to the office. I wasn't taking it serious. These white guys, I'm going to get some money and then we move on to the next scheme or something. And so my wife must have been talking about something that I've been doing, shit, probably fucking with women and probably spending too much money and going out too much. And so they set me up. I was doing this show. Okay. I was doing this show. You were staying here with me, baby, when they do it? All right, so he was doing the show. How you doing, man? And they said, do the toad. I got this medicine that can make you see God, and it's the God monocle. I'm listening to this guy, and I'm high on cocaine right now. I'm saying, what shit you talking about? Nigga, you don't got nothing that I can't see, man. I've been under all the drugs. I've been under this and that, and my meth. And so I said, give it to me. He said, no, this is not like that. This, you got to lay down. You got to do a ceremony. You got to ask God for permission. I'm like, oh, God. So I go there. And you're not going to believe this. Smoke it and listen. I stayed with him, my body went here. I went some places, and man, listen, my whole life changed. I haven't did cocaine in 2 years. I haven't did nothing that I used to do. I don't know what's going on. None of the good stuff is happening.
Is this the toad or is this weed?
No, it's the toad, nigga. Weed is just for me, my personal use. The toad is, ooh, boy, the toad is.
Change your life.
Yeah, I can say that.
I know,
Listen, how could a guy come? Listen, I just had a fucking, I was overdose. I was fat. I was 100 pounds, 85 pounds overweight. How do I do the toe? The next thing you know, I'm 220 pounds. I'm ripped. And I'm talking about boxing exhibition. Everybody wants to see. Everybody's offering all these fucking millions, 110th of millions of dollars to see me in the fucking. We have to see my old ass. Listen, when remember I did that little bullshit shadow boxing in the mix?
Yes. Damn near broke the internet.
Yeah, no, 800 million. Can you believe that? 800 million? Yeah, that was pretty interesting. So I said, I go like this. I'm capable of doing anything now. That shows
that ego again, right? That ego again. It's fueling the ego again.
So, though, that's the difference. The people let the ego run rapid, and they get intoxicated with the ego running rapid. I'm under control. He's under control. Or she's under control. Whatever it is under control. And it enjoys being under control by me because I allow it to have some comfort as well.
You said something to me very interesting when we spoke last week. You said that you didn't necessarily do it for the people. You did it for you. You love doing it Can you elaborate on that and share with the brothers and sisters?
I'm just the kind of guy, me, right? I'm the kind of guy, just whatever I anticipated, if it's not capable of embarrassing me, make me look really stupid, I won't do it.
Wow. Wow.
Having that assessment arrived to my
I got it.
And I have to deal with that ordeal. I can deal with that. There's nothing I can't deal with, I realize. Like losing my daughter, there's nothing I can't handle. I can never be embarrassed. I can never be ashamed of nobody out here, because we're all going to die. And everybody's here trying to have a good image before they die. And I'm just living life, man, on life terms.
Speaking of your daughter, where were you at in your mind? Like, how did that affect you? What did it do to you as a father?
Feeling a good feeling. No, but I'm at a stage in my life now.
I can't hear you. What's that?
This is what we do as human beings. We die.
Right.
Die.
I say you live to die.
Maybe, but maybe by dying, you really begin to live. Death is being my highest potential. Nothing higher than death. Imagine you're able to live long enough to die. And listen, if you die, we want, listen, the life that me and you have right now, even if we were homeless, we got it for free, nigga. You got it for free. Look how much we got in return. I know you. You know me. We're both influential people in our world. You know? I mean, that's a big thing. It may not be big to you or to me, but that's a big thing. Where we came from, we're talking to each other. What's the possibility you ever think you'd be talking to the heavyweight champ of the world? What's the possibility I think I'd be talking to a guy I've known since I was 20 years old, and now he's still here functioning and living? You know, you're not there yet. I'm not there yet. We've seen a lot of things that other people didn't see, and we'll never believe that we saw it.
It's true. This is true. Wow.
I got to get out of here. I got to move here.
I got two more, and I'm going to let you go. First off, I need you to give, there's a young lady that my father's training along with Chicken in Philadelphia. They call her the young Mike Tyson. Her name was Aaliyah the Archer Davis.
So there you have it. Another great video for ES News. For ESNewsReporting.com, I'm Elie Seckbach reporting. And you can follow me on Twitter at Seckbach. And you can follow me on Instagram at Elie Seckbach.